Kuala Lumpur, Daejeon, Honolulu, Macau, Adelaide, Chiang Mai, and Leiden. The latest ICAST was hosted virtually by Kyoto Seika University in 2021 due to COVID-19 pandemic. The 13th ICAST will be held in Surabaya, Indonesia, and hosted by Universitas Erlangga in 2024. Why is Surabaya chosen as the venue for the next ICAST? And what is the relation between Universitas Erlangga and the vision of ICAST? Surabaya is chosen as the venue of the 13th ICAST for its significant history not only for Indonesia, but also for Asia. Known for its epithet of City of Heroes, Surabaya is a symbol of heroism and multiculturalism which runs through the vein of Indonesia's national identity. Its historical root, which is linked to past international trade and Dutch colonialism as well as Japanese occupation, results in a melting pot society in almost every corner of Surabaya. Surabaya is a cosmopolitan space consists of many ethnicities, such as Chinese, Japanese, Indian, Arab, Malay, and even European descendants can be found in Surabaya. Not only varied in its population, the cultural aspects of Surabaya are also diverse. Popular traditional arts such as wayang kulit, wayang orang, and reok can also be found in Surabaya. As a prominent university located in Surabaya, Universitas Erlangga is chosen as the host for the next ICAST. The ICAST program fits to Universitas Erlangga's global vision, which is to establish a global academic community through the development of leading, innovative, and independent international activities. This vision has been implemented in the past through several conferences, seminars, and other activities that focused on Asian issues and involved Asian scholars. ICAST will also mark a significant program for Universitas Erlangga's new research center, Erlangga Institute for Indian Ocean Crossroads. Prior to ICAST, Erlangga Institute for Indian Ocean Crossroads has undertaken several discussions with other international partners. International Convention of Asian Scholars, or known as ICAST, is a convention that functions as a global platform enabling individuals and institutions from different parts of the world to come together to exchange views on a variety of issues pertaining to Asia. Its secretariat is hosted by the International Institute for Asian Studies based in Leiden, the Netherlands. Since 1998, ICAST has brought more than 22,000 academics, civil society representatives, administrators, and artists together at 12 conventions. ICAST promotes interdisciplinary and transsectoral studies that engage partners in Asia as well as institutes elsewhere in the world. ICAST was firstly held in Leiden in 1998. Since then, there have been 12 conventions of ICAST which were located in Berlin, Singapore, Shanghai, Kuala Lumpur, Daejeon, Honolulu, Macau, Adelaide, Chiang Mai, and Leiden. The latest ICAST was hosted virtually by Kyoto Seika University in 2021 due to COVID-19 pandemic. The 13th ICAST will be held in Surabaya, Indonesia, and hosted by Universitas Erlangga in 2024. Why is Surabaya chosen as the venue for the next ICAST? And what is the relation between Universitas Erlangga and the vision of ICAST? Surabaya is chosen as the venue of the 13th ICAST for its significant history not only for Indonesia, but also for Asia. Known for its epithet of City of Heroes, Surabaya is a symbol of heroism and multiculturalism which runs through the vein of Indonesia's national identity. Its historical root, which is linked to past international trade and Dutch colonialism as well as Japanese occupation, results in a melting pot society in almost every corner of Surabaya. Surabaya is a cosmopolitan space consists of many ethnicities, such as Chinese, Japanese, Indian, Arab, Malay, and even European descendants can be found in Surabaya. Not only varied in its population, The cultural aspects of Surabaya are also diverse. Popular traditional arts such as wayang kulit, wayang orang, and reok can also be found in Surabaya. As a prominent university located in Surabaya, Universitas Erlangga is chosen as the host for the next ICAS. The ICAS program fits to Universitas Erlangga's global vision, which is to establish a global academic community through the development of leading, innovative, and independent international activities. This vision has been implemented in the past through several conferences, seminars, and other activities that focused on Asian issues and involved Asian scholars. ICAS will also mark a significant program for Universitas Erlangga's new research center, Erlangga Institute for Indian Ocean Crossroads. Prior to ICAS, Erlangga Institute for Indian Ocean Crossroads has undertaken several discussions with other international partners. International Convention of Asian Scholars, or known as ICAS, is a convention that functions as a global platform enabling individuals and institutions from different parts of the world to come together to exchange views on a variety of issues pertaining to Asia. Its secretariat is hosted by the International Institute for Asian Studies based in Leiden, the Netherlands. Since 1998, ICAS has brought more than 22,000 academics, civil society representatives, administrators, and artists together at 12 conventions. ICAS promotes interdisciplinary and transsectoral studies that engage partners in Asia as well as institutes elsewhere in the world. ICAS was firstly held in Leiden in 1998. Since then, there have been 12 conventions of ICAS which were located in Berlin, Singapore, Shanghai, Kuala Lumpur, Daejeon, Honolulu, Macau, Adelaide, Chiang Mai, and Leiden. The latest ICAS was hosted virtually by Kyoto Seika University in 2021 due to COVID-19 pandemic. The 13th ICAS will be held in Surabaya, Indonesia, and hosted by Universitas Erlangga in 2024. Why is Surabaya chosen as the venue for the next ICAS? And what is the relation between Universitas Erlangga and the vision of ICAS? Surabaya is chosen as the venue of the 13th ICAS for its significant history not only for Indonesia, but also for Asia. Known for its epithet of City of Heroes, Surabaya is a symbol of heroism and multiculturalism which runs through the vein of Indonesia's national identity. Its historical root, which is linked to past international trade and Dutch colonialism as well as Japanese occupation, results in a melting pot society in almost every corner of Surabaya. Surabaya is a cosmopolitan space consists of many ethnicities, such as
Ladies and gentlemen, the guest lecture is about to begin, so please have a nice seat. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Welcome to the guest lecture, Snoek Hurgronje. My name is Dahlia Fatmawati, and I am your host for today. Our Humanities Universitas Airlangga, Vice Dean of the Faculty of Humanities Universitas. The representatives of International Institute for Asian Studies, the representatives of KITLV, Masyarakat Sejarawan Indonesia, our distinguished speaker, our moderator, and our beloved students. With Leiden University. The speaker of today's guest lecture is Professor Wim van is the opening session. The second agenda is the guest lecture, followed by the Q&A session. Then we would like to ask everyone to please rise for the Indonesian national anthem, Indonesia Raya. Thank you, everyone. All of you may take your seat. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to invite the Vice Dean for Research and Community Development of the Faculty of Humanities Universitas Airlangga, Dr. Lina Purianti, to deliver the opening remarks. Bu Lina, the floor is yours.
Don't say sweet ya. Okay, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you everyone, the students, and then I see here also some lectures from Masyarakat Sejarah Indonesia. Is it correct? And then also I didn't make any note here, and then also I think the colleges here from the thank you so much for coming. And there are also some colleges from Leiden University, KITLV, IAS. Thank you so much for joining us. All of us here are coming for listening, for attending the guest lecture by Professor Wim van den Doel from Leiden University. I think the choice of this theme is without any purpose, because in Indonesia itself, we know that the Snow Corbronya is a name that full of controversy. So that's why then this is the time for us to learn from the scholars, and probably in some ways, some students probably think that you are a kind of a representative of the Orientalists. I mean, with this way, with this lecture, so Prof. Wim can show us many layers when we try to understand the Snow Corbronya life in times of the prominent colonial scholars. I'm sure that there are many things that we can learn from this guest lecture. Okay, so time is yours, Pak Wim. So please share with us your perspective, your ideas, your research, your knowledge for this very controversial, but at the same time, we can learn from this. I think he is a kind of a very unique and prominent scholar. Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Hey, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, everyone. The honorable guests, students, lecturers, I know you cannot wait anymore to have the lecture from Professor Wim van Doel. But before we hear the lecture, let me read the bio of the professor. As we always say, tak kenal maka tak sayang. Yeah? So if you don't know him, then the lecture will if you know him more, then the lecture will be more fruitful. Yeah. So, Professor Wim, let me read your bio. Yeah. So, Professor Wim van den Doel graduated cum laude from the University of 1987, after which he was appointed as a lecturer in American history at the Leiden History Department. From 1988 to the beginning of 1990, history section of the Royal Netherlands Army, where he wrote important parts of the book Mei 40, the battle on Dutch territory, including the battle on and the bombing of Rotterdam. He obtained his PhD in 1984 on the European Internal Administration in Java and Madura, 1804. Some students also from Madura Island here, Professor Wim. And if you are willing to visit Madura, with pleasure. Okay. Professor Wim's work have been published such as Silent Power, and then The Empire of Insulinite, For a World to Listen Now. So time is yours.
This one works. Okay. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's an honor for me to be here. It's also a big pleasure for me to be here and to say more than a few words about the life and times of Christiaan Snoek Corbronya. He is a controversial figure. You already know. he was already controversial in its own days, because he was, on the one hand, an advisor of the colonial government, but after he returned to the Netherlands, he became very critical of colonial rule, and he became criticized by those people who actually were behind colonial rule. So in his own days, he was already becoming controversial. After he died, he was seen as a great scholar, and he was really admired by a lot of people for his scholarly work until, let's say, the early 80s. Because in the early 80s, everybody had read the book Orientalism of Edward Said. And of course, Edward Said wrote a book on the Middle East and about how European scholars actually worked on the Middle East. He didn't say anything about Asia. Well, Snooker Hoye is mentioned one time in this Orientalism. But since then, a lot of people thought Oriental scholars are a kind of spies or helpers of colonial oppression. So because they give Oriental people characteristics which actually legitimize colonial rule or imperial rule. So this was then actually, Snook was a part of this, became a part of this story. So after that, he became a kind of, controversial person again, but then from Orientalist perspective. So what I did the last last 6 years, I actually started to study so not as an Orientalist or not as anything else, but as an historian, reading his own letters, also the letters he received, also from his Indonesian friends. And I, as an historian, I tried to understand his life and his times, and I wrote a book about it. It was published 2 years ago, and next Saturday, the Indonesian translation will be published in Jakarta. So you have to wait a few days, but then you can buy my book on Snooker Hoye. But if you have listened to my lecture, you already know everything, so then you don't have to buy the book, but who knows. So next slide. So who was Christian Snooker Hoye? Where did he came from? He came from a very simple village, Oosterhout, forget about it, but a very simple village in the south of the Netherlands at that time. You see this very simple life at that time, but he didn't have very simple parents. This is his father, and this is his mother, and they had a very special history, because his father was a minister in the church, and he was married, not to this woman, but to another woman. He was married, had five children in the province of Zeeland, so also on the countryside. And then he fell in love with the daughter of his colleague, minister of the church. Well, and then he had two women, he made pregnant two women at the same time, this father. And then he ran away with his new love. He ran away to England and then to Belgium, and also Snooker Hoye. So our Christian Snooker Hoye was born, and then they settled in the province of Brabant. He got very rich because his father, the grandfather of Snook, was a very rich man. So when he died, he inherited some big money. So they were well-to-do, but had a very peculiar family life. He was the only man in the family. He only had sisters. I'm not a psychologist, but perhaps at the end of the story, there is something about Snook and women, not only his wives, but also his mother and his sisters. So he was only surrounded by women his whole life. So Snooker Hoye was born in 1857. 1857 was born, and he went to secondary school in the town of Breda. Not a school which could get you into university. So he took some other classes in the Latin and Greek so that he could go to university. So next slide. And to which university he did go? This is Leiden University. This is Leiden University, how it looked like when he started his classes. It looks roughly the same. Now there are more cars on the picture, but for the rest, it's more or less the same picture as it was in his days. What did he study? He did study theology. Like a lot of people in the Netherlands at that time in 19th century did study. If you were for the humanities, the only real option in a way was theology, because after that you could become a minister in the church, you could get a job. So also he started to do theology. What is now important is that theology at Leiden at that time was dominated by Mr. Kühnen. Professor Kühnen was a professor of the Old Testament. And he was a very critical scholar. So he really did his critical studies about the Bible. So not taking everything literally, but really doing research. Who is the author? What time are the Bible books written? You know, this very theological, critical training of the Bible. He was a very important theologian in Europe at that time, Mr. Kühnen. So Snoeker Groenje learned his very critical approach to texts. So the text is not just the text, but you have to study the text and also beyond the text and the text and the other texts. And so you can find out what time actually are these kind of Bible books originated. That's what he learned. So next slide. But Snoop really wasn't very much interested in theology in the end, because he was not a real believer. I think he was kind of agnostic person already in his youth. And so he, after his bachelor, as we call it now, in theology, he switched to Arabic and other Semitic languages, because without the theology, he continued to work on these texts, on his languages. And this new professor of him was Mr. De Goeie. He was a famous professor of Arabic texts. And he was trained. This is Snoeker Groenje when he was young. Ladies and gentlemen, this is your age. Or some of you, at least, in this room, are the same age of Christian Snoeker. This is how he looked like when he was a young student. De Goeie, like Kühnen, you could call him Orientalist now, because they were studying the Orient, or the cultures of the Orient. From where did they study the Orient? They studied the Orient from Leiden. They never left Leiden. They studied the Arabic world just from text. This is what people did in the 19th century. Sitting in their offices, sitting at a study, reading texts and analyzing texts, but never visit Arabic world or never visit Indonesia. They simply did study the Orient from sitting in their chairs behind their desks. So next slide. Snoeker Groenje graduated from Leiden, did his PhD in 1 year, ladies and gentlemen, example. So he did his PhD in 1 year on the religious ceremonies in Mecca. But he did it, of course, in the way he was trained. He did it through texts. So he studied the Quran, he studied Islamic legal texts, just to get to the bottom of where do these kind of celebrations in Mecca come from, and how did Muhammad adapted perhaps these ceremonies to Islam. But he did it from Leiden. He never left Leiden, and he felt that it was not good enough, because this sitting in a room reading text. What do you learn from the real society, real Arabic society or real Muslim society? What do you learn? Not so much, he thought. So he got this idea that he wanted to go to Jeddah, to what is now, to the Hijaz, to what is now Saudi Arabia. He wanted to go himself, to see for himself how Muslim society actually looked like. And this man on the on the left of the picture, he was the consul, the Dutch consul in Jeddah. And why was there a consulate of the Netherlands in Jeddah? Of course, because of the pilgrims from the Dutch East Indies. A lot of people came from the Dutch East Indies to Jeddah to go to pilgrimage to Mecca. And, well, a lot of people were ripped off by Arabic guides. So they came poor back from Mecca, and then they had to be helped by the consulate to return to the Dutch East Indies, to Indonesia. So there was a consulate over there. This is the consulate, by the way. So this is where, this was the diplomatic house of the Netherlands in Jeddah. But he also was a little bit concerned of the pilgrims, because he thought those pilgrims come from Indonesia, they go to Mecca, they are radicalized, and they come back to Indonesia, and then they are a threat. At least that was his idea. So we need to know more about the pilgrims from Indonesia. And who else could do the research? Snoek Vergroenje. So he came, he went to the Dutch government and said, we need a scholar in Jeddah, actually to learn what's happening with the pilgrims. But the Dutch government didn't want to finance that. They said, this Mr. Snoek Vergroenje, he doesn't know any Malay, he only know Arabic, so how can you study pilgrims if you don't speak the language? So they didn't want to have anything to do with it. So this consul, he went to rich people in the Netherlands, and they financed his time in Arabia. So this is the myth number one. In all those controversial, where he's a controversial figure, they say he was hired by the government to be a spy, which is simply not true, because the government didn't want to have anything to do with Snoek at that time. It was this man who was personally concerned and paid, or let other people pay, for his time in Jeddah. Okay, now he's in Jeddah. You see, he's in Jeddah. This is the vice consul, by the way. He's in Jeddah, and then people say to him, his friends, he becomes friends with people from Jeddah, from people from Mecca. They say, why don't you visit Mecca? Why don't you see it for yourself? And then he decides to go to Mecca. Is this strange in a way? Well, you need to be Muslim, of course, to enter Mecca, as you know. But he said, well, there are a lot of white people from the Balkans, Muslim people, so I look like, I don't have to disguise myself, because there are a lot of people who look like myself who are Muslim who go to Mecca. So it's not dangerous for me. But he let himself be circumcised in Jeddah, so he became Muslim, or at least we don't know, because we don't know what his inner thinking is. But of course, he started to live a life of a Muslim. That's clear. And then he went to Mecca, also as a scholar, and also as a modern scholar, because he took his photo camera with him. And this is the 1880s, so the photo camera is a very new instrument. So he's a very modern scholar. He goes to Mecca, he lives there, he studies Islam in the great mosque, and he takes a lot of notes. And then at a certain moment, he has to leave Mecca, which is a long story I won't tell, because it's too complicated, and it has something to do with the Germans and the French and some archaeological artifacts. And the French are the bad guys here, Philippe. It's a long story, but the French are the bad guys. And then Snoek has to leave Mecca. And then he returns to Leiden. The next slide, please. These are the pictures he took. So this it now looks very different, of course, but it's... you can recognize the Kaaba and the mosque. Here are the pilgrims gathering for the pilgrimage. Next. And then he comes back, and then he writes his famous book on Mecca. His first book is the book on the history of Mecca, and the second book on Mecca is the most famous one, because there he describes everyday life in the city. So everyday life, and it was the first time that a scholar actually really wrote about how life was in Mecca. And one thing he found out, that the pilgrims didn't radicalize at all in Mecca. They came as they went. So they went as they came. So they were the same people. They were not more radical when they visited Mecca. They were simply doing their religious duty, and it had no real influence on what they thought. So a third volume of the book are the pictures. So this is the pictures. So the next slide, please. Pictures in the book. So this was a collection of Mecca, which was barely made Snoekerhorje very famous. And these are pilgrims from Aceh, and he took pictures of all types of pilgrims in Mecca. So next slide. Okay, then he thought, I've been to Mecca, I've seen Islamic society, and I've learned a lot from it. And now I want to go to Indonesia, because I want to go to this biggest Islamic society we know, and of course also a Dutch colony, and I want to go to Mecca. And he approaches the government, can I get an assignment? I want to be your advisor, and so on. And in the end, the ministry said, okay, let's send you to Indonesia for 1 year and see what happens. And this is the Indonesia he comes in 1889, so the last part of the 80s in the 19th century. This is Jakarta, or Batavia, as it was called, like this. This is the Harmonie, which doesn't exist anymore except for a bus stop. Right? So in Jakarta, you have the bus stop Harmonie. And this is around this place where life was much quieter. No cars. You had a tram, but it was a quiet, nice life in Jakarta. So this is the world where he starts his career in the Dutch East Indies. So next slide, please. Yeah, quiet life, quiet life. Much better than today's life with all the cars, I think. So next slide, please. So one of the first assignments he gets is to study the revolution or revolt in Banten in 1888. So 1 year before he comes to Java, there is this uprising in Banten, and these are this is the colonial army. And people who are arrested because of this uprising. And he started to study, so why did this happen? And he soon found out that it happened, according to him, because of bad colonial rule. So this is the first critical remarks he makes of... Sound again, yes. So he's very critical about colonial rule. And one of the main faults So, what is wrong with Dutch colonial rule, according to Snoekerhorje, is that the Dutch civil servants in Banten don't take the Indonesian or the Sundanese or the Javanese, Bupatis and Wedonos, they don't take them serious enough. And they really, for instance, to be European. They force them to drink alcohol, or to be, in the Dutch parties. So he says, if you do that, they in local society. And so that's why people come to an uprising. Also because of in Banten at that moment, so the taxes are too high. So he's quite critical about the So this is because this is how in the late 19th century colonial this one, yeah. This one. Oh, it's because of the I'll be here. I will hear. Sorry about that. I'll be here. So this is how colonial rule looked like. Huh? So this European or Dutch civil servant, assistant resident, assistent resident, And he is working together with the regent, the Bhupati, who are sitting on. The others actually are the Vadonos and Jaksa, perhaps, I don't know, but they are sitting on the floor. So, but Snook's criticism was that this white person, this Dutch civil servant, actually, they were pushing aside the Indonesian civil servants because they didn't trust them, because they thought Indonesian civil servants are corrupt, so we have to be, you know, we need to have a strong colonial rule. Next slide, please. Snoeker Gooije then also started Snoek did also his research on Java. So he was assigned to learn about Indonesian society in Java. Did he do that alone? No, he did not do it alone. These are his two main assistants. So on the left, there is Said Uthman, who is an Arab Islamic scholar from Batavia. And the other one on the right is Haji Hassan Mustafa. He is he became in the end the chief Pengulu of Bandung, but he is also a very important Islamic scholar at the time. Why, and Snoek and Hassan became very close friends, and Snoek liked him very much. And why did Snoek Gooije liked Hassan Mustafa? Because he was a Sunanese poet, and he also was very engaged in having Islam and the Sunanese culture being in harmony. So he was very much about adapting, but having Islam and the Sunanese culture in harmony. And Snoek really is convinced that this is how, in real life, Islam is practiced. It's not like the Islam of the Arabic world. In every place in the world, Islam takes its own form because you have the local culture. And he explains this to his Dutch audience or his European audience. He explains this, look at Christianity in Europe. You know, look at Christianity in Europe. If you go to the south of Italy, people will have celebrations with Maria on the shoulder, a lot of music. You know, this is also very Catholic, but also very Christian. But if you go to certain places in the Netherlands, of course, there are no statutes at all. So the Protestant Christianity, no statutes. So somehow, and we have a Christmas tree during Christmas, which is a pagan symbol. So somehow in Christianity and the local culture has merged somehow. And of course, that makes a different type of Christianity in the south of Italy, for instance, as in the north of Europe. Are the people in the south of Italy less Christian than in the north of Europe? No, he says, they are all the same Christians. So this is also what he tells the Dutch about Indonesia, because some Dutch thought at that time, Indonesians are no Muslims. They are actually Hindu with a kind of Muslim layer. So inside, they are all Hindu. Islam really doesn't exist in Indonesia, because there are so much customs, you know, which we do not recognize as Muslim. As Snoek says, this is all nonsense. Indonesians or people from Java or Sudanese are 100% Muslim, even if they have merged their traditions with Islam. I know this is a discussion also, but this is what Snoek thought. So this was his, and therefore he liked Hassan Mustafa very much, because he had the same kind of ideas. Next slide, please. So he goes, this is Chanjur, the mosque. So he travels along Java, and he learns a lot about how Islam is being practiced on Java. Next slide. And on Java, to be precise, in Chamis, he also meets a Sunanese wife, a woman. And he married. He married with, this is the daughter of the chief Pengulu of Chames. This is the chief Pengulu of Chames. And this is his daughter. And Snook Hegonje marries her in an Islamic way. And he takes her to his house in Batavia. He takes her home with his wife. He takes him to Batavia and he lives with her. And I think he loves her. And in the end, four children are born in this marriage. Next. Okay. Before I go to Aceh, so what is the influence, what is the importance of Snook Hegonje on Java? He studied the Islam on Java and he starts to advise affairs. We have a fresh microphone. So what does he do? What is this influence on Java? Well, I think very briefly, he teaches the government how to deal with Islamic issues. So he says that the Dutch government has to respect Islam very much. He also wants to have the proper way of doing for instance family law in Islamic way. So the Islamic family law has to be done in the proper way. This means, for instance, that Pengulus, who are sometimes just a friend of the Bupati, so not knowing a lot of Islamic law, he says every Pengulu who is appointed should be appointed through my office. I want to know who he is. And this person should really know Islamic law, otherwise I don't appoint him as Pengulu. And of course, Snook Hegonje was respected because he knew more about Islam than many other people on Java. So he was respected because of that, because of his knowledge of Islam. And he tries to make the Dutch government to apply all kinds of Islamic rules in the proper way. This is what I think one of the important things is what he does. So every conflict on mosques, those should we support the building of a mosque, yes or no? And the local civil servant then sends this question to Snook Hegonje, and then he writes an advice, yes or no, we should help or not. So he helps the government, especially in Islamic affairs, to do it in the right way, whatever the right way might be, but that's what he does. Okay, now going to another chapter, so the controversial chapter, in a way, of Snook Hegonje's life, the war in Aceh. So this war in Aceh started in 1873, so long before Snook Hegonje actually went to Indonesia. And why is this war started? Very simple, well, very complicated, but if you want to make it simple, you simply say the Suez Canal is opened, and that's why shipping is no longer through the Strait of Banten, through the Indian Ocean, but goes to the Strait of Malacca through the Suez Canal. Very simple. Because Aceh is also a place where you have piracy. So all kind of international players, other governments say to the Netherlands, well, do something about this piracy. And this is, of course, how the Aceh War starts. In 1873, it's not very, for the Dutch side, not very successful. And then the Dutch decide to withdraw to the area around Kota Raja. Around the capital, and this is the only part of Aceh actually controlled by the Dutch, and the rest is pirates, sultan, a lot of other people. Actually, it's without colonial rule. But this is what Snook Hegonje is facing. He went to Aceh in 1819, so already 1 year after he came to Indonesia. He went to Aceh. He sits there for half a year. He learned the language in, let's say, 2 months' time, So he's a kind of, yeah, he's very special with languages, so to say. And then he learns from all kinds of Achenese people what's going on in the other places and what the Achenese society is. So next slide. Oh, this is the picture of this boundaries, where behind it's the Achenese, and this is inside this area where the Dutch control, and they check everything going in, going out, as you can see. That's how it looks like when Snoepervoorje was there. Next slide. And of course, this research results in another, like Mecca, so two volumes and a picture volume. So this is one of the pictures in this volume on Aceh. And what he describes is how Achenese society is built, how it was is constructed, without a strong sultan. So we should not think of the sultan because he's not important. Then you have Islamic teachers, Islamic leaders, which are the true leaders of the society. So if you want to conquer Aceh, you have to go after them and not after the sultan. And thirdly, perhaps they are interested in a good colonial rule, because now it's wartime and people are poor. So if we conquer Aceh, then we should give them a proper rule, good rule, and then everybody will be happy and so on. So this is the short message of Snoepervoorje in the book. So next slide, please. Well, it takes quite a time, but this book was published in 1891. And of course, at that time, the government really did read the report of Snoepervoorje, but they didn't take any action. Also a long story, because they believed that Teuko Umar was taking care of the situation for the Dutch, so everything was fine, until of course Teuko Umar switched sides and then fought the Dutch. And then suddenly government realizes, hey, we have to do something else. Let's take this book of Snoepervoorje again and learn how to do it. And then he got the assignment, Snoepervoorje, to work together with Jo van Heus. This is van Heus, became also governor general, or notorious general. And this is Snoepervoorje. And they are here on tour fighting in Aceh. Next slide, please. Well, fighting in Aceh, of course, also means killing a lot of people. So this is really a bloody war fought also by Snoepervoorje himself. He is there. He is behind the troops or on horseback. And he likes it a lot because he is in the open air and he is with the soldiers. And he is living he is very happy at that time, actually. But a war, of course, which is very bloody. By the way, this is an interesting picture. Huh? So because you see Achenese people killed by the colonial army, but you also see the colonial army is in part, a lot of Indonesians are in the colonial army, because you see a few European faces, but you see a lot of Indonesian soldiers. So this is, again, you can make history very complicated, huh? Because this is also part of this history, so it's not simple. It's a complicated story. But of course, the Aceh War was in a way successful. It never really stopped the Achenese rebellion, but more or less the war was stopped. Next picture, please. But then, at around this time, his wife dies. And this is one of this darkest moment in his life. And I have written, there are a few little notes in Leiden University's library of Snoepervoorje, where he describes how his entire life has become, you know, a black life. He is really shocked by it. Again, this is also myth, you know. He uses his wife to spy or study indigenous society or Sundanese society. I think this is completely wrong if you read his letters, because he really loved his wife first, because the next one comes later in my talk. He loved her very much, and he really liked living in Sundanese circles. He didn't like to live in colonial circles. He thought this was all superficial, people who want to get rich or make careers. He didn't like that. So he liked very much life in Sundanese circles. Of course, it's not simple Sundanese circles, because this is the Bhupati again of Chamis. And these are his four children. And they were taken care of by the wife of the Bhupati, the Raden Ayu Lasmita Kusuma. Very interesting figure, a champion of local industries, actually, in Chamis. Also went to Brussels to an international exhibition with the local products. So he's very, if we want to write a topic for a good master thesis, pick her as a topic. It's a great story for you. So if you want to become famous, write a book on Lasmita Kusuma. But she took care of the children of Sukhavoyan. So they went to Chamis and they were raised by the Bhupati. So Snook liked life in Sundanese circles, but of course these are the highest circles in society. So he liked the life of rich Sundanese people. I have to say that. Okay, next picture, please. So, but of course, this is Snook at the heydays of his career. I think this is a picture from 1902, so he's really big, he's really a famous man at that moment in Batavia, seen as the number one scholar of Islam in the world, successful advisor of the government, successful in Aceh, falls in love again, second wife, Hua, and gets a son, Yusuf, with her. So second wife, child number five. Okay, next slide, please. So this family picture, unfortunately, one of Snook's children is missing here, but he is really here. But on the PowerPoint, he's left. So this is a family picture from Snook's Indonesian children. But then he gets in quarrels with Mr. Van Hertz, who is the Governor General. And in 1906, he leaves Indonesia for the Netherlands. And woman, wife number three, he marriage is in the Netherlands again, Ida Oort, and gets a daughter, Christine. So then he has actually six children and two wives at that moment, which is not allowed, but Well, some people really knew about this, so it was not a real secret, but nobody in these days, there was no social media, no Twitter, so there was no real big debate on this, so only a few people knew, and that was it. Okay, next slide, please. So this is Sukhavoy as a Leiden professor. He comes back to Leiden, and he is, you can see it from his eyes, he is a famous man. He's a famous professor. Next slide, please. He lives in the Snoekerhooyenhuis. If you are in Leiden, you can still see it. And there's Snoekerhooyen on the door. Yes. By the way, professors did have this such a big houses because there were no lecture rooms. So everybody did this lecturing at home. So this is why you needed such a big house, but actually the first floor was the seminar rooms and the lecture rooms. So next slide, please. Okay, back in the Netherlands, he tries to write another book again, but then on Ottoman Islam or Islam in Istanbul. This is Istanbul, he goes to Istanbul, but he actually never really again is able to do this kind of research. Somehow he is not able to do it again. So he has written books on Mecca, on Aceh, but also on the Gayo lands. So there's a third series of books, but then he tries to do it again on Istanbul, and he doesn't really succeed. So that's one of his big frustrations in life, that he really is not able to continue his scholarly work. Next one. He becomes very critical of colonial rule, and he once the Indonesian civil service give them more prominence. And this is the Bhupati. Actually, yeah. This is Surabaya, and this is a controleur, so a low-ranking Dutch colonial civil servant here on the left. I think the picture tells you that he is the superior, and he is sitting and is at his desk. Sukhavoya wants to have even more power transferred to the Bupatis, because he thinks that the Netherlands and Indonesia can really be joined together if there is a group of Indonesians from the elite who can live modern life together with the Dutch. And they should be associated together. So they should associate themselves with the Dutch culture without losing Islam, of course. You can be Islamic and modern, according to Sukhavoya, and you can associate yourself with Dutch culture. So this is his idea, let's say in 1908, when he makes this kind of pleas to the Dutch government, please give more prominence to the Indonesian, or at least on Java, the Java on Madura, the Java and Madurese elites. That is his wish, and the government not really listening to. This is one of the few happy days of Sukhavoya in his later days, because this is his son, Yusef, and he is married Madeleine Wiranata Kusuma, and she is the daughter of the Bupati of Bandung. So he's over there. Wiranata Kusuma is over there. He also plays a role in independence, so in West Java, Pasuruan, Dan. And Gulu, Mr. Rushdie, also a good friend of Sukhavoya. And now this is a big day for Snoek. He's in the Netherlands, of course. Wiranata Kusuma telephones Sukhavoya, because at that time you could have a direct telephone call to the Netherlands, and he tells, My daughter will marry your son. And so your son now is really a member of the Sundanese elite. So this is great news for Sukhavoya. So Snoek has very great friends. Next picture. And he still has some influence, because in Batavia, in Jakarta, there is this Office of Indigenous Affairs. Office of Indigenous Affairs, Inlandse Zaken. Kantoor voor Inlandse Zaken, an Office of Indigenous Affairs. And all these pupils, so the students of Sukhavoya are the heads of this office. So this is Mr. Kern. Well, you can't see it properly, but this is the picture of Snoek hanging in the office of this Bureau of Indigenous Affairs, Mr. Kern. And actually this office advises the Dutch government, the Dutch East Indies government, on what's happening in local society. And they say what we see, because it becomes First World War, becomes 1918, they say there is a nationalist movement emerging in Indonesia. And they say you have to democratize the government in Indonesia. So this group of people are really, you know, the progressive minds in the colonial bureaucracy. They warn, they say, we have to change, we have to give the world, give Indonesia a more democratic government, but unfortunately, the government doesn't listen because of all kinds of reasons. Actually, the oppression becomes, how more the nationalist movement grows, the bigger the oppression gets. But these people are warning all the time against what the Dutch are doing. And Sukhavoya becomes also more and more critical on the colonial government. He criticized them in newspapers, in a lot of things. And in the end, he warns the government, if you do not give autonomy, he doesn't speak about independence, but it's in the 30s. If you don't give Indonesia autonomy soon, there will be a violent end to Dutch colonial rule. That's his warning. Next one, please. Another way of influencing the Dutch government is by training all the diplomats who are going to Jeddah, to Saudi Arabia. So these are all Dutch trained, the snook who are going to train people. This is also a famous person after, during the War of Independence. So this is Jeddah. So he also influences the Dutch in Jeddah. Next picture, please. And he is very much, he is completely, he admires the Saudis, because of these the news coming from Saudi Arabia to him. He is a very big admirer of the Saudi family. The king, he calls a political genius. Even Saud, he is called a political genius. This is the crown prince visiting Leiden University in 1935. And Snoeke Groenje, the old one, old man, is the host. Snoeke Groenje is also very anti-Zionism. So he is also writing in the newspapers against Jewish land settlements in Palestine. And he compares that with pure colonialism. So he thinks what the Jews are doing in Palestine is occupying land of Christian and Muslim Arabs. And this is the same type of attitude as people from colonialism has. So he's a very, let's say, progressive and very critical person at the end of his life, very much criticizing colonial rule and other types of colonial rule in the world. So next one, please. Yeah, so this is one of his last days walking around near Leiden. This is a last picture of Snoeke before he dies. And you can see that he is perhaps the kind of disappointed man. You can read in pictures what you want, of course, but I read in this picture that he is a disappointed man because his project of association of the Netherlands and Indonesia has failed, he knows. Dutch has started to oppress the nationalist movement. He's very much against it. So he's also very pessimistic about the future. He thinks there will be a war. Well, he was right, of course, but he predicts a war between the Netherlands and Indonesia if nothing changes, and he is very pessimistic about it. So this is let's say he is a disappointed man at the end of his life. Next picture, please. In the 1936, he dies on a Friday, and he doesn't want to be buried in public. He doesn't want to have any, because he is disappointed, he doesn't want to have a big speeches during his funeral. He wants to have it a very quiet affair. And on Monday, he is buried here at Leiden. You can visit his grave besides his mother and two of his sisters. I didn't talk about his sisters in my speech, but he's buried without anyone present. So he was buried there on Monday, very lonely way as a disappointed man in 1936. So this is what I wanted to have by way of introduction on Snoeke Groenje. Is he controversial? I don't know. That's up to you. Of course, is he controversial? But I think if you take his life and his times and his story, nothing is black and white. So everything is very, you have to see it in its time. It's very nuanced. Of course, he made mistakes. Who doesn't make mistakes? He marries, he's double married at the same time. He doesn't take his children back to the Netherlands. When he goes from Indonesia to the Netherlands, he leaves his five children behind and his wife. They get money from him, so he takes care of him financially, but it's in a way, it's quite tough to leave your children behind. So that's not very nice, I think. But he has a great scholar. I think his books, you can still read them. I saw the Indonesian translation on the book. You can still read it. So it's still readable. after all those years. He was a great scholar. And I think as an advisor of the government, he both advised on the war of Aceh and he advised to respect Islam. But there are two sides of the same person. So black and white, I don't think so. But it's up to you to make your own decisions about Snoepke Goeie. But thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Wim, for your stories that bring us following the life of Snoepke. So now we open the question answer session. I will take from this side one. So there will be five questions from each bar. So, or anyone who wants to have a question, then you may raise your hand, mention your name, your institution, and then your question. All right. Okay. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. So we take three questions first from the back. Yeah.
It's a distance. Okay. So if you are more here, that's better with the microphone.
Yes. Ya, good afternoon and assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My name Alvin Widi Santoso from the Historical Science Department in Erlangga University. And perhaps I question about the Snoepke-Goeie in mainstream opinion is a traitor or maybe must go to hell, gitu. And my question is, in the post-colonial or in the right Islam or conservative Islam and in Indonesian context, Snoepke-Goeie as the Orientalist was so hated by the ex-colonialized people. Well, on the another hand, according to Michael Lafon in his introduction about the history of Islam in Indonesia, he have argument if Snoepke-Goeie had made a scientific contribution to the history of Islam in Indonesia. So how do we as a historical academics or many scholar deal with this ambiguity of the past? Thank you.
How as a historian, you deal with Snoepke-Goeie? That was your question.
Oh, yeah. In the post-colonial context, Snoepke-Goeie as the Orientalist was so hated by the ex-colonialized people, while on the other side, This is Hugronya had made a scientific contribution to the history of Islam.
Well, the last thing I think is clear. I mean, Sloop of Hoyen was a great scholar of Islam, yes. And again, if you even you read his Mecca book, it's you can still read it as a scholarly work. So he is very important as an Islamic scholar. But all his advisors and his advisors are also translated into Indonesian, the library, and read them all. Well, it's his interpretation to all kinds of issues about Islamic taxation, about how to interpret I you can only admire, I think, his knowledge of Islam, and of course you can disagree on what his interpretation is of certain issues on Islam. That's clear. Of course, he also lives in the colonial days. It's not his fault. He is born in 1857. He dies in 1936. That's colonial days. So he is a part of this colonial world. So he's a part of, he's a child of his own times, as we say. So he's really a part of his own times. And you can't blame him, of course, when that he lived at that time. I take some offense to this idea that he was a kind of spy, you know, wanting to oppress people or something like that. I think that's totally wrong. So he wanted to have good colonial rule, whatever it may be. So he wanted to have, within the context of his life, he wanted to really have the best way of dealing with all kinds of issues. Yes, and of course, in his days, the Dutch were asked also by international powers to win the war in Aceh, and he took. Yeah, you can. It's up to you. You can make your own judgment, because he took his idea that he did research on it, on Acehese society, and used it to stop the war. You can also say that. That's interpretation. You can have your own interpretation, which is the nice thing of history.
Yeah, Mas Alfian, so it's answer your question? Okay, thank you. And then next, there is a question. Okay, but yeah. Is that right from you? Okay.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Eva. I'm from Historical Science Department. That was very interesting about life of Dr. Snok. In some sort, it is stated that while studying Islamic in Mecca, Dr. Snok converted to Islamic, but it has been said that he But it has been said that he was only pretending to convert to Islamic for history. And what's your opinion?
Yes. Did he convert only for his research? I mean, this was he was criticized that he converted to Islam to do research. Also, in on Java, he pretended to be a Muslim just to. And then do his research, and through this research, the Dutch government could oppress the people. I mean, this is short. This is your question. I don't think that is true. So I think he was not a very strong believer, anyhow. So he was not. Yeah, he was Christian, but he didn't go to church. So he was really. So he was really a scholar. I think that is. That's something we really know. We don't know, of course, what really went on in his inner self. We don't know because he doesn't write about it in his letters. I think we know, again, what is historical fact. We know that he lived the life as a Muslim in Indonesia. So he lived life as a Muslim in Indonesia. So he didn't drink any alcohol, he prayed, he did everything. He lived life with his wives, who are also Muslim. So he lived an Islamic life. Was he a true believer? We don't know, I would say. But it's not true that he simply converted to be able to do his research. No, I don't think so. He was very much really interested in Islamic society. He wanted to understand Islamic society. He had his good friends, so which are Islamic scholars themselves. I showed them, and he admired them. He admired especially Hassan Mustafa. And he respected them. And then he wanted to understand how does this Islamic society works, especially on Java. So how are there all kind of practices still done with everyday life, with when a child is born, when there are marriages, you know? So why are people in Sudanese countryside doing it differently than in Eastern Java? So how come? Of course, then he really comes with this idea that Islam connects with the local custom, and that's why it's different in Madura than in Bandung. So it's our differences. And then he says this is normal. So there is no pure Islam. And he is a little bit against, for instance, there's also a nice part of the story. He is against, at a certain moment, he is against immigration from Arabia. He doesn't want to have too many Arabs coming to Indonesia, because those Arabs, they bring a type of Islam to Indonesia he doesn't really like. So he wants to keep them out. So he wants to keep the Indonesian Islam as it is, because it connects with Islam, is Indonesian culture. But this is his idea. So that's a scholarly idea. So this is not, he's genuine interested in how this society is a part. So to think that he converted to be able to spy, I mean, that's much too simple also. It's totally, I reject that.
So Prof. Wim disagree to the opinion that it is only a tool, yeah, to do the research. Yeah, hopefully it's answered correctly for your question, Baifa. And then we still have 5 to 10 minutes. Yes, two questions from this side. Okay, first you and then you, Yamba.
Okay, thank you for your explanation. It's very extraordinary. My name is Baskoro. You can call me Bas, and I'm from Historical Science Department. Actually, your explanation is break the stigmatization about snow kurgonje. But it seems you haven't explained why Indonesian history still portray the snow kurgonje as an evil, because yet we know that eventually there is another Dutch person who actually looks like a snow. His name is Multatuli or Toosteker, who criticized the government of Dutch in Indonesia, but he praised by Indonesian history and praised as a hero. But why snow kurgonje cannot praise by Indonesian history and praise as hero too? Just like this. Thank you.
So you also asked the difference between Multatuli and snow kurgonje, and appreciation of Indonesians for the two people, two persons. That's a very interesting question, because actually, I think Multatuli is quite colonial. So his book, Max Havelaar, is a very, people sometimes say it's an anti-colonial book, but I think it's a colonial book, because he criticizes the Bupati. The Bupati is the evil person, the corrupt person in the story. And the Dutch assistant resident, he is the hero of the story. And actually, this links with snow kurgonje, because then people in the Netherlands were reading, young boys were reading the book and say, hey, I want to fight evil in Java. So I want to be a colonial civil servant fighting the Bhupatis, because the Bhupatis are corrupt. I simplified a little bit. But he, of course, nowadays you can say he fights corruption, and is a good story. But of course, as a result, the Dutch civil servants, they didn't take the Bhupatis any serious anymore. And of course, Snoek is then criticizing the Dutch for not taking the Bhupatis serious. So this is, but it's not the answer to your question. It is simply a nice little story on Multatuli. Why Snoek of Hoorn is still, I think there is this idea in the 80s, you know, that this all Orientalists are evil people, more or less. So all those scholars from England and France, they study Middle East, and then they create this image of the weak Arab, and then it legitimizes imperial and colonial rule in the Middle East. And somehow Snoek has become a part of that story, and which is, I think, wrong, but that's he is a part of the story. And of course, he fought the war at Aceh. Yes, you can't deny it. He wrote the strategy of the Dutch army, and he said you have to get after the Islamic leaders, local leaders. The Sultan you can forget about because he's not important. You have to fight the war in this way. So yes, he did that. So he's also part of this conquering of this war in Aceh. It's no way to deny this. But there's no, I tried. So this is what I did as a historian. I'm not an Orientalist, I'm not an Islamic scholar, I'm a simple historian, reading the letters of Snoek of Hoorn, reading all kinds of other papers, so really as an historian, and trying to reconstruct his life and his ideas. So that's what I did. And then I think you see a very nuanced picture of his life. So it's double. He's anti-colonial. The end of his life, he's very much anti-colonial. Even Sukarno, in 1931, when he was at the court in Bandung, before he was sentenced by the Dutch colonial government, even Sukarno uses Snoek to say, "Well, oh, at least Snoek of Hoorn understands me." So this, all kinds of people don't understand me, but Snoek, the later Snoek, so the critical Snoek, he is my friend. And so, so Snoek of Hoorn is a complicated figure, but that's why you have to read his whole life and his times. So that's what I tried to do. I wrote a book about it, so I hope this book will change a little bit. It will be in Indonesian, so on Saturday, next Saturday, it will be published by Obor in Jakarta. So perhaps the picture of Snoek in Indonesia will change a little bit after you have read my book. I don't know. We'll see.
Thank you. So we just wait for the book, yeah? Launch, yes, okay, 6 days, yeah? All right. And then the question from Mbak, yeah, silakan Mbak.
Thank you for the time. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Anggina Raktaviani from Historical Science Department. As far as I know, Snoek of Hoorn is known as an advisor to the Dutch government, especially on the Aceh issue, but he was also known as a respected Orientalist on that area. Now the question is, what were his important contributions to the development of Indonesian histories? Indonesian studies.
So Snoek's contribution to Indonesian studies, that's your question. Well, I think that what he, I think is also one of the first persons who actually goes to the, he lives with the society. So what he did in Mecca, he also does on Java. So he travels around, he talks to a lot of people, and he really wants to know how everyday life, he's a sociologist or anthropologist in a way. He wants to know how it really is, not from books, but from visiting villages and talking to people. What the only thing you can say is that he mostly talks to the elite. He never talks to peasants, but he talks to the Bhupati, the Pengulu. So these are the people he talked to. So you can say perhaps he has a kind of elitist view of society. But he's the first one who who really does it. I mean, who really does research in society. So not from books, not from texts, but really from people. So he's a kind of pioneer, if you look like that. Then when he is at Leiden, he trains all the civil servants who go to Indonesia, and he has his PhD students. So he has a lot of manuscripts, and then he has a lot of PhD students. But his Office of Indigenous Affairs does also a lot of research on Indonesian society. So I would say that he's a kind of pioneer in anthropological and sociological studies of Indonesian society. So I think in that sense, he's quite important. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. We still have one or two more questions, but before that, I'm going to give a chance from my right side. Is there any question from my right side before I give the back? Oh, okay. Yes, Mas, silakan.
Good afternoon, Professor. My name is Rushdan. I just recently finished my bachelor study. My question is, my first impression listening about Snok Horkronya is in my high school. I was give a work about make a film, make a study about Snok Horkronya. I play a role as Teku Umar in Aceh War. So this moment is a very good moment that I can bring some nostalgia about Snok Horkronya itself. And my question is, I think there is a missing part about Snok Horkronya where he is a Dutchman, where he is identified as a man with nationality Dutchman itself, where from your lecture, you explained to us about he is a loving husband of great husband from a beloved wife and a really good researcher that we can imagine how he is a good researcher itself. But I think there is a missing point when Snok Horkronya is a Dutchman itself and he is Dutchman. He has a nationality about Dutch itself, and I think it is a very important point where he chose a side between Indonesian or Dutch itself. Thank you. I think it's my question.
Yes, thank you very much. I think good question. Complicated question in a way, but it's a good question. There's a question is, I talked about Snok Horkronya, but perhaps I didn't stress too much that he is a Dutchman. He's from the Netherlands, and he is born in the Netherlands, and he has grown up in the Netherlands, and he studied in the Netherlands. So where is this Dutchness? I think it's a very good question. So there are, I think, two parts of the question I think I would like to answer. First is personal life, and then is political views. So first is his personal life. I think his personal life, he really is much happier in Sundanese circles than in Dutch circles, at least in Indonesia. If you read his letters, he is in Batavia, and he doesn't like the Dutch society over there, because a lot of people come there just to get rich or to, you know, it's a kind of superficial, he thinks it's a kind of superficial society, colonial society. He has a few Dutch friends, but are scholars. So very few friends from the Netherlands in Indonesia are linguists, are archaeologists, so they are really the scholars, and he meets them in this Batavian Society of Arts and Sciences on the Medan Merdeka, where now the National Museum is. So this is this scholarly organization or society. He meets them. So there are a few Dutch friends, but they are not the common colonial Dutch person that are the scholars. He likes them, but for the rest, he likes life in Sundanese circles. I don't know why, but he thinks that's more profound life, it's better life, So in that sense, he loses his Dutchness in a way. So he becomes more a part of local society than Dutch society. But that's his personal life. But of course, he's also still Dutch because he leaves Indonesia for the Netherlands and he becomes a Dutch professor at Leiden University, famous professor. So he's, you can see, okay, back to his personal life. He's very much a Protestant, so he doesn't like festivities. He's a very stern man, works very hard. So people say this is a Protestant type of life. So not to celebrate too much, but have a. That's what they do. In the end, of course, he says, "I'm from the Netherlands, so I want the Netherlands and Indonesia to be two parts of one unity." So he really believes that this is good for the Netherlands and it's good for Indonesia. And of course, his ideas about this association between elites. And of course, this is what doesn't work because of the Dutch policies. And then he becomes very much against Dutch politics, and he becomes a disappointed man because he sees that what he thought the future was for a kind of Dutch Indonesia or union, it falls apart. And then he gives up in a way the Dutch Indies, and he says, give Indonesia as soon as possible self-rule. Otherwise, there will be a war. That's what he says just before he dies. And of course, in the end, he's right. This is what happened. But he is sad because he's Dutch. That's why he is sad and I think disappointed at the end of his life. Perhaps that this answers your questions a little bit.
All right. Thank you. We still have time for one more question. Okay, right in front of
you. Thank you so much. My name is Dika from Historical Science Department. My question, thank you so much for Wim. And Snok talk, we said, on his knowledge and experience become the basic foundation of the doctrine that the enemy of colonialism is not Islam as religion, but Islam as a political doctrine. Snok concept is based on the fact that Islam society doesn't not have a hierarchical and universal organization. How about your opinion, the concept inside by Snok? Thank you so much. How your opinion about the concept inside by Snok? Yes.
Yes, also a good question. Snoeker Gronje doesn't see Islam as a threat to a colonial rule or to any rule at all. So he is in favor and he promotes religious freedom all the time. And he also says you should not interfere with the Hajj, for instance. People should be able to go and no regulation. So he's very the Dutch try to regulate the Hajj. Because of, also very pragmatic reasons that the people from Indonesia go to Mecca and then they don't have money to return. So they want to have, regulated the hearts. Snook says no regulation, all freedom of religion. So regardless which religion, it should be free. And Islam is not a threat to colonial rule at all. And Islam and modern life can go together. So it's also not that Islam stops development or something like this. Islam is no problem at all. But political Islam is. Why? Because political people use Islam. In his opinion, they misuse Islam for their political purposes. So he is very much afraid. He's very angry on his German colleagues who make the Ottoman Empire declare holy war in 1914, in the First World War. He's totally appalled because there you see Islam is misused for political purposes. And he's very much against. And he also is if he also advises really to arrest people in the Dutch East Indies who really want to use Islam as a political tool to make a holy war or uprising. Please arrest those persons and send them to prison or some other place in the colony. But this is his opinion. Yes, I can't. This is his opinion. What to say about it? I think he, at least he says that a lot of people, I think this is the last thing I would like to say about it. There was a lot of suspicion among the Dutch about Islam, but also about religious orders, so the tariqat. So they were afraid because what is happening there, and these kind of Sufi type of Islam, what are they doing? No, this is all strange and so on. So people were afraid on the Dutch side about Islam, and he said, no, those people are practicing Islam. Let them do it, because there's no threat. So in a way, he actually argued against intervene by the government in Islamic practice. So in general, he says, let everyone do what he or she wants to do. Of course, if there was a quarrel between two people who want to build a mosque, but of course he chooses sides. So he said, we have to help this one and against that person. Or, I mean, there are a lot of debates going on, and of course he takes sides. But that's his. He thinks that's his job. So to take sides.
Thank you very much. Because of the time, so we have to end the guest lecture today. Give a big applause to Professor Wim van den Doel. Thank you very much. And I give the floors back to the host. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Wim and Ibu Dewi, for bringing us to a very fruitful guest lecture today. And before we conclude our guest lecture today, we would like to extend our gratitude to Professor Wim. So we would like to invite the Dean of the Faculty of Humanities, Universitas Airlangga, Professor Dr. Purnawan Basundoro, to extend a token of appreciation for Professor Wim. Thank you, Professor Purnawan and Professor Wim, and ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the organizers, we would like to say thank you for your participation for today. Have a good day. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Oke, buat teman-teman mahasiswa, ada link presensi online, mohon diisi juga. Tautannya akan kami tampilkan di layar. Silakan mengisi daftar kehadiran. Teman-teman, mohon untuk berdiri untuk sesi foto bersama. Untuk teman-teman mahasiswa, silakan berdiri dan maju ke arah depan dan tengah untuk sesi foto bersama.
This lecture kurang teh. Ini bahasa Inggris harusnya ngerti.
Nutrisi.